Hello everyone, myself Suresh, professor from BMS College of Engineering. I am teaching this module 2 and module 3. So these two modules talk about open channel hydraulics. Module 2, you are going to study uniform flow, and module 3, you are going to talk about this non-uniform flow. Under this module 2, as I mentioned earlier, you're going to study about uniform flow. So under this chapter, you're going to study, start with the introduction, classification of flow through channels, Chase's and Manning's equation for flow through open channel, most economical channel sections, uniform flow through open channels, numerical problems. Then we move on to specific energy and specific energy curve, critical flow and corresponding critical parameters. We are going to end this module with numerical problems. Now, at the end of this module 2, you are in a position to design open channels of various cross sections. So when I'm talking about various cross sections, you are going to study rectangular section, triangular section, circular section, and the most important one is trapezoidal section. You're also going to study, or you're going to design, the most economical section for the cross sections which I mentioned just now. In addition to that, you're in a position to understand the energy concepts of fluid in open channel, energy dissipation, and you're in a position to draw water surface profiles at different conditions. With that, let us start this open channel flow. First, we'll define what is a open channel. Kindly recall, in third semester fluid mechanics, you studied flow through pipes. Now, this is one step ahead of what you studied in your third semester. Now, open channel is very important for a civil engineer, which I am going to mention in the next slide. Let us define what is an open channel. So it is a duct in which the fluid flows with a free surface. So in order to explain this concept, I gave a simple sketch at the bottom of the slide. Please refer to the sketch. Here I showed the fluid and also the atmosphere. So water flows with a free surface. So what is this free surface? It is a line that demarcates atmosphere and the fluid flowing. So at the free surface, we have atmospheric pressure acting. Now, coming to the types of open channel flow. So open channel flows are broadly classified into two types of channels. One is natural channels, the other one is man-made channels, or these man-made channels are also called engineered channels. Now, under these natural channels, so we have rivers, we have streams. Now, channels constructed for water supply, irrigation, drainage sewers, culverts, and storm drains are man-made channels. To give an example of this man-made channel, I presented two sketches here. One is without water, the other one is with water. So this slide present a few more man-made channels. So in the first case, you are going to see a channel or a canal, so used to supply water to the field. So from the figure, you can see that there is a field both on the left side and right side of the channel. Now the water that is flowing in the channel, so you can divert that water to these fields on both the sides. The second one, to the right of the first figure, you're going to see a sewer pipe, a circular sewer pipe. Next to that, you're going to see a culvert. So in the top figure, there is no water, And in the bottom one, you're going to see water is flowing in the culvert. Bottom two pictures, what right now you're seeing are the main canal and the secondary canal, which you're going to study in irrigation engineering in the higher semesters. Next point, why this open channel flow is important for a civil engineer and in particular hydraulic engineers. Open channel flow is very important because of three reasons. One is, so civil engineers are interested in studying the velocity distribution. The second one is developing a stage discharge relationship. The third one is optimal channel design. Now we'll go one by one. Velocity distribution. Now, the discharge flowing in a stream or a river directly depends on the velocity of flow. Also, the erosion that is happening at the bed of the channel or the river and also at the sides depends on the velocity of flow. That's why velocity is important. Come to the second one, discharge stage relationship. Now, during a heavy rainfall or during a flood, there is huge quantity of water coming from the upstream side and flowing in a stream or a river. This is one case. Suppose if you consider a dam, during heavy rainfall in the catchment area, large quantity of water is entering into the dam upstream. That we call it as reservoir, which you are going to study in the higher semesters. Now, the question I am asking is, so how do I know how much quantity of water is coming from the upstream side? Right now, I am talking about the discharge. Now remember, there is huge quantity of water coming from the catchment area. You cannot directly, go to the upstream side and measure the discharge. So there what we are going to do is, we make use of what is known as this discharge stage relationship. Okay, so to give a flavor about this stage discharge relationship, so here in the picture on the right hand side, I presented a staff. All of you are familiar with leveling staff. Similar to that leveling staff, there is a staff that is placed in a river or a stream, and the depth of water that is flowing in the river or a stream is directly correlated to the discharge flowing in the stream. So what I mean to say is, knowing the depth of water flowing in a stream or a river, you can directly estimate what is the discharge flowing at that particular point. That is the advantage of developing this discharge stage relationship. Coming to the last point, optimal channel design. So optimal design or most economical section is the one that carries maximum discharge for a given cross section and a bed slope. So being a civil engineer or being a hydraulic engineer, so you need to design a channel which carries maximum discharge. So that's the reason this open channel hydraulics is very important for a civil engineer and in particular this hydraulic engineers. With that, let us move on to the next one, that is basic concepts. Kindly recall, in fluid mechanics you studied three laws. One is law of conservation of mass, law of conservation of energy, and the last one is impulse momentum equation. Now, based on this law of conservation of energy, you studied Bernoulli's theorem. So what is the statement of the Bernoulli's theorem? Bernoulli's theorem states that the total energy remains same all along the reach. In other words, the total head all along the reach remains the same. Now, you already studied that this total energy consists of three types of energies. One is potential energy. Potential energy is also known as datum energy. Then we have the pressure energy. And finally, we have velocity, kinetic energy. Now, if you put these energies in terms of pressure heads, then you have the datum head that is given by Z. Then you have the pressure head that is given by P divided by gamma. And you have this kinetic head, or it is also called velocity head, that is V square by 2G. So the total energy or total head at any section in a flowing fluid is given by P by gamma plus V square by 2G plus Z. So this is constant all along the reach. This is what you studied in the third semester fluid mechanics. Now we are going to use this Bernoulli's equation in order to understand this open channel flow. Just a recap again. Conservation laws, law of conservation of mass. Mass can neither be created nor be destroyed in a system. So that is what I mentioned in the last paragraph. The second one, law of conservation of energy, and law of conservation of momentum. Law of conservation of mass. So if you recall, we derived continuity equation based on law of conservation of mass. Okay, then law of conservation of energy. So this law states that neither the energy can be created nor be destroyed in a system. It only changes its form. In open channels, the energy will be in the form of potential energy and kinetic energy. So very important, in open channels, the energy will be in the form of potential energy or datum energy and kinetic energy. Potential energy is due to the elevation of water parcel, while the kinetic energy is due to its movement. Again, I'll take you back to third semester fluid mechanics. Okay, in chapter 3 or chapter 4, you studied about this Reynolds number. How you define this Reynolds number? It is the ratio of inertia force to viscous force. In other words, when I am talking about flow through pipes, okay, so inertia force dominates over viscous forces. That's why, so based on this Reynolds number, we classified the flow as laminar flow, turbulent flow, and transitional flow. That is in case of pipe flow. But when you talk about open channel flow, here water flows by gravity. So with reference to that, we define another dimensionless number called Proud's number. So Proud's number is defined as the ratio of inertia force to gravity force. In case of pipe flow, Reynolds number. In case of open channel flow, we talk about what is known as Proud's number. Okay, with reference to this, I mentioned about this second point. So potential energy or the datum energy is due to the elevation of water parcel, while the kinetic energy is due to its movement. What is kinetic energy? Kinetic energy is V square by 2G. Potential energy is given by Z. So coming to the last point, in the context of open channel flow, total energy between any two sections is conserved. So what do you mean by that? That we'll see in the next slide. So this conservation of energy principle leads to classical Bernoulli's equation, that is, the total energy at any point is given by pressure energy P by gamma, kinetic energy V square by 2G, plus the potential energy or the datum energy, so which is constant throughout the reach. When used between two sections, this equation has to account for the energy loss between the two sections, which is due to the resistance of flow. What do you mean by that? So kindly recall, so professor mentioned you that we have two types of fluids. One is an ideal fluid, the other one is a real fluid. In case of an ideal fluid, we are not considering the friction between the flowing fluid and the boundary with which the fluid is flowing. In that case, if you consider two sections along the ridge, okay, the total energy at section 1 is equal to total energy at section 2. Now, if you apply total energy at section 1, total energy at section 1 is given by P1 by gamma plus V1 square by 2G plus Z1. Come to total energy at section 2. Total energy at section 2 is given by P2 by gamma plus V2 square by 2G plus Z2. So equate these two equations. Again, I repeat, this equation holds good for a ideal fluid. Now, if you talk about a real fluid, okay, so kindly recall, all fluids available in nature are real fluids. If that is the case, so at section 1, the total energy equation is given by P1 by gamma plus V1 square by 2G plus Z1. Now come to section 2. At section 2, the total energy is given by P2 by gamma plus V2 square by 2G plus Z2 plus, never ever forget to add the drop in pressure between section 1 and section 2. So the drop in pressure or drop in energy between the two sections is given by HL, small h subscript L, that is heat loss due to friction. That is, in case of a real fluid, there is a resistance to flow. So due to this resistance to flow, there is a drop in pressure from section 1 and section 2. So if you want to apply total energy or Bernoulli's equation between two sections in case of a real fluid, so the equation you are going to use is TE1 is equal to TE2. TE1 is given by P1 by gamma plus V1 square by 2G plus Z1, that is equal to, so TE2, that is given by P2 by gamma plus V2 square by 2G plus Z2 plus HL. So equate these two equations and find the unknown. This is how you are going to apply Bernoulli's equation both for a ideal flow or ideal fluid and a real fluid. Come to the last point, which I mentioned just now. The flow of water in an open channel is mainly due to the head gradient and gravity. Just now I mentioned about Proust's number. It's the ratio of inertia force to gravity force. Gravity forces dominate over other forces. So that's why we are talking about a dimensionless number called Proust's number in case of open channel flow. Come to the last conservation law, that is conservation of momentum. This law states that the rate of change of momentum in the control volume is equal to the net forces acting on the control volume. Since the water under consideration is moving, it is acted upon by external force. This leads to Newton's second law. Now, the next question is, sir, where we are using this conservation of momentum? So you are going to study this module 4, module 5, module 6. Module 4 talks about impact of jet on wings, and the remaining modules talk about pumps and turbines. This impact of jets, pumps and turbines are based on this impulse momentum equation or conservation of momentum. done. What is the difference between pipe flow and open channel flow? As I mentioned earlier, so in third semester, you already studied this flow through pipes. Now you are studying this open channel flow. So the question I am asking is, what is the difference between pipe flow and open channel flow? Just now I mentioned one difference. In case of pipe flow, viscous forces dominate. That's why you have the Reynolds number. In case of open channel flow, gravity forces dominate and hence you have the Proust number. The first difference. Come to the second difference. Please refer to the figure. Okay, consider the pipe flow. A fluid is flowing in the pipe under pressure. What do you mean by that? The pressure of fluid flowing in the pipe is more than atmospheric pressure. I repeat, the fluid flowing in the pipe is more than atmospheric pressure. Since the pressure of the flowing fluid is more than atmospheric pressure, if you insert manometers at two sections separated by a distance L, the fluid will rise in the manometer at section 1 and section 2 to a certain height. Okay, now kindly refer to the figure. We are measuring the pressure with respect to a arbitrary line. This arbitrary line is called the datum line. Datum line is an arbitrary line with respect to which we are going to measure the pressure. So from the figure, the datum head is given by H1 at section 1, H2 at section 2. Just now I said the fluid rises in the manometer or a piezometer to a certain height at section 1 and section 2. Then we talk about what is known as pressure head. Pressure head at section 1 is given by P1 by gamma. At 2 it is given by P2 by gamma. Above this pressure head, you have the kinetic head. So kinetic head depends on the velocity of flow. So at section 1, the kinetic head is given by V1 square by 2G. At section 2, it is given by V2 square by 2G. So if you refer to this figure, I mentioned about what is known as HGL and EGL. So this EGL is sometimes called as TEL. What is this HGL? HGL is called hydraulic gradient line. And this EGL is called energy gradient line, or it is also called TEL, total energy line. What is total energy? Total energy consists of datum energy, pressure energy and kinetic energy. So the line connecting these three energies at the two sections form EGL or TEL. This is about the pipe flow. Now come to the open channel flow. Again, so there is what is called as a bed slope. That's why you're seeing a inclined line. And again, we are measuring the pressure with respect to an arbitrary line. That is nothing but the datum line. And certain depth of water is flowing in the channel. At section 1, this depth is given by D1. At section 2, it is given by D2. Now we mentioned about what is known as free surface. So that free surface, here I mentioned it as WSL. WSL stands for water surface line. Now above this, you have a kinetic head similar to pipe flow. Again, that is given by V1 square by 2G, and at section 2, it is V2 square by 2G. Now you may have one question. Sir, in case of pipe flow, the pressure head is given by P1 by gamma and P2 by gamma, but here you mentioned this pressure head as depth D1 and D2. So how you got this D1 and D2? for this. So kindly go back to your second chapter, fluid mechanics, pressure and its measurement. There you studied about this pressure and you derived an equation for this intensity of pressure. What is the equation you derived? The pressure at any point is given by P is equal to gamma, the specific weight of the fluid, into the vertical height from that point to the free surface. P is equal to gamma into H. Now I want the pressure head. So H is called the pressure head. So H is equal to P divided by gamma, the intensity of pressure divided by the specific weight of the fluid. Now in this case, at section 1, P1 by gamma, I am going to replace that by D1. Second one, P2 by gamma, I am going to replace that by D2. That's why I didn't put this P1 by gamma and P2 by gamma in the figure. Okay, now kindly recall, when we defined this open channel flow, I said at the free surface pressure is acting, atmospheric pressure is acting. Okay, so in case of an open channel flow, the free surface itself represents the hydraulic gradient line. Second difference. I repeat, in case of an open channel flow, the free surface represents the hydraulic gradient line. This is another difference. Let us summarize these differences. Look at one by one. Pipe flow, open channel flow. The fluid completely fills the pipe and flows under pressure. That is the reason if you install piezometers at different sections, the fluid rises in the piezometer to a certain height. But in case of open channel flow, flow takes place due to the slope of the channel bed and gravity forces dominate over other forces. So in case of a pipe flow, viscous forces dominate over other forces. And in case of pipe flow, the flow in a pipe takes place due to difference of pressure. That is, here it is pressure gradient and here it is due to gravity. So in case of a pipe flow, the flow in a closed conduit. And in case of this open channel flow, the flow must be classified as open channel if the fluid has a free surface. Okay, then now I mentioned about HGL, I mentioned about EGL. Let us see what is this HGL and EGL. So hydraulic gradient line HGL is the sum of the elevation and the pressure head that is connecting the water surfaces in piezometers. The energy gradient line, or TEL, total energy line, is the sum of the HGL and the kinetic head. The amount of energy loss when the fluid flows from section 1 and section 2 is indicated by small h subscript L, that is head loss. Come to open channel flow. In case of open channel flow, the hydraulic gradient line corresponds to the water surface line, that is nothing but the free surface, where it is subjected to only atmospheric pressure, which is commonly referred to as zero pressure reference. For the time being, let us not bother about that. HGL corresponds to the free surface or the water surface line. Then energy gradient line is the sum of the HGL, hydraulic gradient line, and the velocity head. Again, the amount of energy loss when the fluid flows from section 1 and section 2 is indicated by small h subscript L. For uniform flow in an open channel, this drop in the energy gradient line is equal to drop in the channel bed. I repeat, for uniform flow in an open channel, the drop in the EGL, energy gradient line, is equal to the drop in the channel bed. I'm going to talk more about that when I'm deriving an equation for this uniform flow. Now, again, let us go back to third semester fluid mechanics. There, we classified fluid flows into different types. Kindly recall, we classified the flows as steady flow, unsteady flow, uniform, non-uniform flow, one, two, three-dimensional flows, laminar and turbulent flows. These are the different types of classifications which you studied in third semester fluid mechanics with reference to pipe flow. Now, with reference to open channel flow, again, we'll see what are the types of flows. The first one, classification based on time criterion. Again, we have two types of flows. One is a steady flow. The second one is a unsteady flow. So how do you define this steady flow? How do you define a unsteady flow? So we have what are called physical parameters. What are physical parameters? The depth of flow, the velocity of flow, temperature, density, and pressure. These are called the physical parameters. Now, if these physical parameters do not change with respect to time, then the flow is said to be a steady flow. What do you mean by that? I consider a stream. Morning 9 o'clock, I go measure the depth of flow, or I measure the velocity of flow. Again at 10 o'clock I am going to measure, 12 o'clock I am going to measure, 3 o'clock I am going to measure, tomorrow morning 8 o'clock I am going to measure. Now, whether it is at 9 o'clock, whether it is at 8 o'clock, whether it is at 3 o'clock, the depth remains the same or the velocity remains the same, then that flow is said to be a steady flow. What is the equation for this? The equation for steady flow is given by dou p by dou t, the variation of pressure with respect to time equal to 0, the variation of velocity with respect to time is equal to 0, the variation of temperature with respect to time is equal to 0, and the variation of depth. So depth is given by y, or it is represented by y. So dou y by dou t is equal to 0. So when I'm talking about a steady flow and unsteady flow, so time is the criterion. We are going to define these parameters with respect to time. Now, unsteady flow. So these physical parameters, such as the depth of flow, velocity of flow, temperature, density, and pressure, if they change with respect to time, that type of flow is known as unsteady flow. What do you mean by that? So I'll go at 9 o'clock, I'll check what is the velocity. I'll go at 10 o'clock, I'll check the velocity. Now, the velocity at 10 o'clock is not the same as the velocity at 9 o'clock. Then we say that the flow is a unsteady flow. So this unsteady flow is given by the variation of pressure with respect to time is not equal to 0. The variation of velocity with respect to time is not equal to 0. The variation of temperature with respect to time is not equal to 0. And the variation of depth with respect to time is not equal to 0. Now, all flows that are available in nature are unsteady flows. That's about steady and unsteady flows. We'll go to the next classification. Next classification is based on space criterion. So based on that, we are going to define two types of flows. One is uniform flow, the other one is non-uniform flow. Again, if the various physical parameters such as depth, velocity, temperature, density and pressure, if these physical parameters, if they do not change along the course, or if these parameters do not change along the reach, R-E-A-C-H, then the flow is said to be uniform flow. And the mathematical equation is given by dou P by dou S, where S is the reach or the distance, the variation of pressure with respect to the distance, the variation of velocity with respect to S, the variation of temperature with respect to S, the variation of depth with respect to S is equal to 0. So to give an example, suppose if the length of the stream is say about 5 kilometers. At the starting point, I am going to measure the depth. My y1 is equal to say 1 meter. Now after 1 kilometer, I am going to measure the depth. So at 1 kilometer, my y1 is equal to 1 meter. Similarly, at the end of the stream, if the depth is equal to 1 meter, then the depth remains same all along the reach. Then that type of flow is called uniform flow. Then what is non-uniform flow? If the depth changes from section to section, suppose at the starting point, the depth is 1 meter. At about 500 meters, the depth is 1.5 meters. At 1 kilometer, the depth is 2 meters. So if this depth changes from section to section, so then it is called a non-uniform flow. How you are going to define this non-uniform flow? If the various physical parameters such as depth, velocity, temperature, density, pressure do change, please underline that, along the course of flow, then the flow is said to be a non-uniform flow. And all flows available in nature are non-uniform flows. I said all flows available in nature are unsteady non-uniform flows. Then non-uniform flow is very important for a civil engineer. So non-uniform flow is also called varied flow. Now there are two types of varied flow or non-uniform flow. One is called the gradually varied flow. It is represented by GVF. The other one is rapidly varied flow, RVF. What is this gradually varied flow and what is this rapidly varied flow? Now, if the depth changes gradually, if the depth changes gradually along the length of the channel, then we call the type of flow as GVF, that is gradually varied flow. Now, if the depth of flow changes rapidly or suddenly over a very small length of the channel, then we call the type of flow as rapidly varied flow. This is the difference between gradually varied flow and rapidly varied flow. Now, under module 2, you are going to study uniform flow, and under module 3, you are going to study this non-uniform flow, where you are going to study about this gradually varied flow and rapidly varied flow. Kindly recall, I said, in case of open channel flow, we have this dimensionless number called Prout's number. So it is defined as the ratio of inertia force to gravity force. Now, based on this Prout's number, we have three types of flows. One is critical flow, second one is subcritical flow, the third one is supercritical flow. Now, Prout's number, that is given by f of r or f of n, if this value is equal to 1, we call the type of flow as critical flow. If the Prout's number is less than 1, it is called subcritical flow. If this Prout's number is more than 1, we call it as supercritical flow. So based on the value of Prout's number, we have three types of flows: critical flow, subcritical flow, and supercritical flow. For critical flow, so Prout's number is equal to 1, subcritical, Prout's number less than 1, and supercritical, Prout's number greater than 1. Then, here, so what are the things you are going to study in case of uniform flow and non-uniform flow? So under this uniform flow, I mentioned about this gradually varied flow and rapidly varied flow. So to give a flavor about this uniform flow and non-uniform flow, so I picked these pictures from the internet. The first one, what you're seeing is uniform flow. So the depth remains same all along the ridge. But if you refer to figure B, the depth changes from point to point or section to section. So figure C represents steady varied flow, that is over a spillway crest. And figure 4 and 5 are D and E, talks about unsteady varied flow and unsteady varied flow in case of a tidal surge. So let us not confused with this figures. I'm going to give a clear picture as we proceed further. Now, if you look at this picture, in this picture, this is a handwritten sketch. So you're going to see a uniform flow, a non-uniform flow. Under this non-uniform flow, I mentioned about both GVF and RVF, and again a uniform flow. Okay, so kindly go back to your third semester of fluid mechanics. You studied about wares. Kindly recall Woogie wear. The one what right now showing in the picture is a Woogie wear and a sluice gate. What is this Woogie wear and what is this sluice, that I am going to explain in the later stage. So just to give a flavor, so where you will have the uniform flow, where you will have the non-uniform flow. When I am talking about non-uniform flow, it may be GVF or it may be RVF. Okay, I put this sketch. So with that, let us move forward. Let us talk about the geometrical properties of a channel section. The first one is depth of flow. So depth of flow is given by y is the vertical distance of the lowest point of a channel section from the free surface. Then, for the first time, I am introducing these two terms. One is wetted area The other one is wetted perimeter. Wetted area is given by capital A. Is the cross-sectional area of the flow normal to the direction of flow? Then wetted perimeter is the length of the channel boundary in contact with the flowing water at any section. To give an example for this wetted area and wetted perimeter, let us talk about a rectangular section. Suppose if the depth of the rectangular section is say 5 meters and the width is 2 meters. So if I ask you to find out what is the area of the rectangular channel, it is 5 into 2, 10 meters square. But if you allow water in this rectangular channel whose depth is only 1 meter, and if I ask you to find what is this wetted area is given by the width, that is 2 meters, into depth, that is 1 meter, depth of water flowing in the channel. So in that case, the wetted area is 2 into 1, that is 2 meter square. Similarly, if you talk about the wetted perimeter, it is 1 plus 1 plus 2, that is 4 meter is a wetted perimeter. You must be very, very careful. So again, I am repeating, whenever you are talking about wetted area and wetted perimeter, you are talking about the depth of water which is in contact with the boundary. That's very, very important. Based on this wetted area and wetted perimeter, we define another term called hydraulic radius. This hydraulic radius is also mentioned as hydraulic mean depth, HMD, or it is also called hydraulic mean radius, HMR. And it is given by capital R, is the ratio of wetted area to the wetted perimeter. That is, capital R is equal to capital A divided by capital P. The next property, hydraulic depth. Hydraulic depth is given by capital D. It is the ratio of wetted area to the top width. Top width is given by capital T. Therefore, this hydraulic depth, that is capital D, is given by capital A divided by T. Now, let us talk about two sections, rectangular section and a trapezoidal section. In case of a rectangular section, the bottom width is equal to top width. If I call this bottom width as capital B, your top width T is equal to capital B. But if you talk about a trapezoidal section where the bottom width is equal to B and the top width is not equal to B. Okay, so we are going to talk about this capital T in the later stage. For the time being, the geometrical property hydraulic depth is the ratio of wetted area to the top width. Capital T is equal to A divided by T. So please look at point 6. Top width T is the width of the channel section at the free surface. These are the geometrical properties. Now, at the beginning of my lecture, I mentioned that you are going to study rectangular section, trapezoidal section, triangular section and circular section. Now, with reference to these various cross sections, let us see what are the geometrical properties. So for a rectangle, the wetted area is given by B into Y. Please refer to the figure. Now for a trapezoidal section, it is given by B plus NY into Y. You must be very careful. So your N represents the side slope. For every n horizontal, there is one vertical. For every n horizontal, there is one vertical. So for a trapezoidal section, wetted area is given by b plus ny into y. For a triangular section, it is given by a is equal to ny square. And for a circular section, it is a is equal to 1 by 8 into theta minus sin theta, that whole thing multiplied by d square, where d is the dia of the circular section. That is about wetted area. Similarly, wetted perimeter, capital P for a rectangular section is given by base width plus 2 times the depth of flow, that is 2y. Now for a trapezoidal section, this perimeter is given by b plus 2y into root of n square plus 1. And for a triangular section, this perimeter is given by 2y into root of n square plus 1. Kindly look at this trapezoidal section and the triangular section. So the difference between trapezoidal section and triangular section is, okay, for a triangular section, there is no base width. Simple way of remembering the various geometrical properties for a triangular section is, so you consider the geometrical properties of a trapezoidal section. Wherever b is there, you simply put b is equal to 0. You are going to get the properties for the triangular section. Okay, so similarly, for a circular section, the perimeter is given by half of theta into d. Another important point you need to remember when you are writing these geometrical properties is, you need to be careful about the notations what I mentioned. With reference to the figure and the notations, I am writing these equations. Then, coming to the third one, top width. For a rectangular section, bottom width is equal to top width, therefore capital T is equal to B. But in case of a trapezoidal section, top width is equal to bottom width plus 2ny. Now for a triangular section, top width is equal to 2ny. And for a circular section, T is equal to sine theta by 2 into capital D. So once you know these three properties, the remaining properties or secondary properties or these properties are based on the primary properties such as wetted area, wetted perimeter and top width. So hydraulic mean radius R is given by A divided by P. For example, if you talk about a rectangle, so for a rectangle, A is equal to B into Y and P is equal to B plus 2Y. Therefore, R is equal to BY divided by B plus 2Y. Similarly, write the equations for the other cross sections also. Finally, you have this hydraulic depth. Hydraulic depth is given by wetted area divided by the top width. So for a rectangular section, wetted area is given by BY and the top width is nothing but B. Therefore, you are going to get hydraulic depth is equal to Y. So similarly, you write the equations for trapezoidal section, triangular section and circular section. The next question, sir, why do we need these properties? So these properties are important. So while solving the problems, so this slide will be a ready reckoner. That is the reason I summarized the properties with respect to the different types of sections which you are going to study under this module.